Hey guys, thanks for tuning into the message. It's going to be 30 minutes long, preached by Pastor David, and it's going to be really awesome. So enough of me, roll that video.
Dang, Daniel. Daniel? Dang, Daniel. Dang. Back at it again!
All right, guys, how you guys doing tonight? I'm so excited to be able to be speaking to you guys tonight. It is honestly one of the greatest honors that we have leadership here that believes in the people who go here, that they empower us. And I want to see more of you guys on stage preaching. I want to see you, Darius, come on. I want to see more people coming up on the stage preaching. But I'm so thankful for Pastor David that he lets me have the honor of speaking to you guys. And if you're wondering where he's at, he is actually this weekend gone away with his wife, and they went to a marriage retreat. And let me just tell you this. This is kind of like a side note. I was thinking about this earlier. I'm so thankful also for leadership that doesn't just say how to do things, but they actually live it. And so they don't talk about just how to have a good marriage, but they actually do what it takes to have a good marriage. And so I'm so thankful that our pastor said, hey guys, I'm going to be gone for the weekend. I'm going to miss mezzanine because I'm going to go spend time with my bride. And we're going to go invest in our relationship. So I'm just thankful for leadership that actually lives out what they preach. Amen? Are you guys grateful for that? Yeah. Man, that was kind of sad. Are you guys grateful for that? Yeah. Sweet. So we are right in the middle of the Daniel series. Dang, Daniel. This is week 3. The first week we talked about standing out, about how not to conform to the world, how to stand out for the sake of the gospel. And last week, we talked about standing up for what is right. And tonight, I get the honor of talking about standing strong. So if you're taking notes tonight, the title of the message tonight is called Standing Strong. But before we get into it, let's pray because I need Jesus. Lord, thank you for being here tonight. Holy Spirit, we just invite your presence and we ask you to just come speak to us. I pray over every heart and I ask that you right now would open our hearts. Give us ears to hear you, God. Give us eyes to see you, Father. I pray that you would just help me to communicate your thoughts, God. Help me to communicate what you're saying tonight. And Holy Spirit, I just say, have your way. Do what you want to do tonight. I've planned and I've prepared, but I will lay that all down to see what you want to do tonight, God. We're so grateful for your presence. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right, so I have a question for you guys. How many of you guys would say that you eat healthy? Like, I'm talking like carrots, granola, kale. You healthy people, I actually have a shirt that says, oh, kale, no. That's like my favorite thing. I wear it to the gym. I see you healthy people. Now, how many of you guys would say you're on the other end of the spectrum? You think about cake 90% of the time. If you're like me, you're thinking about them chicken nuggets. That's what I'm saying. Like, I have such a desire to be healthy, but I have a greater desire to eat chicken taquitos. You know what I mean? Like, I actually have a picture if we can put this up. Put it up right there, maybe. It says fit-ish, semi-fit, kind of fit. Someone who likes the idea of being fit but equally likes food. Y'all, that is me. I like the idea of being fit, but I equally love chicken nuggets, okay? I want to tell you, this time I was in high school, and I was like, super like, I'm going to get fit and I'm going to be healthy. And I was really focusing on eating healthy, which that's like 90% of the battle, honestly. And which is hard for me because, as you guys know, I do not like vegetables. So what do I eat? I just ate a lot of fruit. I said no to the Cheetos because the Cheetos get me every time. And I actually lost like 20 pounds, right? I lost 20 pounds and I'm like, I'm doing so good. I'm so fit. I'm losing weight. But then my dad would come in with a box of donuts. No, you guys don't understand. You don't understand. If you don't know me, I love donuts. They are straight from the hands of Jesus. And so, amen. I heard that amen, Hector. And so I'd be like, man, I'm so fit. I'm doing good. What's up, donuts? And I feel like I'd have like this inner dialogue where I'd be like, I'm not going to eat you. And that donut would be like, oh, yes, you are. And I say, get behind me, Satan. And next thing you know, I've eaten 6 donuts. Now, some of you think I'm exaggerating. That's the sad part. Some of you think, no, surely Allison would not eat 6 donuts in one sitting. All I can say is, you don't know me. You don't know my life. But I don't know. I mean, I think I'm doing good. I think that I'm going strong on the healthy thing. And then I eat 6 donuts because the spirit of high calorie came against me. Amen? Spirit of high calorie, right? But I don't know if you can relate to that at all, because I can. But sometimes, and here's where I want to kind of tie this into what we're talking about tonight. Sometimes we can deal with this on a spiritual level, right? Where we're going along through life, we're doing our thing, we think we're doing good, and then suddenly something, life hits us in some way. That could be a doctor's report. That could be a breakup. That could be you didn't get the job that you wanted, or you didn't get into the program at school that you wanted, or you're struggling somehow in your family. Can anybody relate to any of that? Where you're walking through life and then suddenly life hits you and you have the opportunity to choose how you're going to respond. You can either stand strong or you can give in to what's coming against you. And so what we're going to do tonight is we're going to take a look at Daniel, about the life of Daniel, and look at what it takes to stand strong in the face of extreme adversity. So what we're going to do is we're going to look at chapter 6. Chapter 6 is kind of an iconic chapter. A lot of people know the story. It's the story of Daniel in the lion's den. How many of you guys like learned that when you're like in Sunday school, right? The felt boards. Well, what was cool is as I was reading this story that I know like the back of my hand, I felt like God was showing me things that I had never seen before. And so I want tonight us, even if you've heard this story a million times, I want us to dig in tonight and listen to what the Holy Spirit is saying. So we're going to start in Daniel 6, verse 2 through 3. And just so you know, last week we talked about Daniel. He was serving under King Nebuchadnezzar. Now at this point in the book, he's serving under King Darius. I see you over there. I felt like the whole time, anytime I talked about Darius while I was writing this message, I just pictured Darius over there. So what's up, Darius? King Darius. So anyway, that's where we're at here. Now he's serving under King Darius. We're going to pick up in Daniel 6, chapter 6, verse 2 through 3. It says, the king also chose Daniel and 2 other administrators to supervise the high officers and protect the king's interests. Daniel soon proved himself more capable than all the other administrators and high officers. Because of Daniel's great ability, the kings made plans to place him over the entire empire. So basically what's going on here is Daniel has worked his way up. If you remember in chapter 1, Daniel was captured. He basically was like slave status, but at this point, he has worked his way up. And one thing that I love about Daniel is I love the diligence that he shows. It says, Daniel soon proved himself more capable than all the other administrators and high officers. Because of Daniel's great ability, the kings made plans to place him over the entire empire. So basically, he's pretty much second in command. He doesn't answer to anyone except the king, which is pretty awesome. Let's pick up in verse 4. So it says, then the other administrators, the one that Daniel was better than, the other administrators and high officers began searching for some fault in the way Daniel was handling government affairs. But they couldn't find anything to criticize or condemn. Listen, he was faithful, always responsible, and completely trustworthy. Come on. So they concluded, our only chance to find grounds for accusing Daniel will be in the connection with the rules of his religion. I love how it said that he is faithful, always responsible, and completely trustworthy. Basically, Daniel was the man. And these administrators were jealous, and so they were trying to find some way to bring him down. Now, let me just, this is a side note for you. God loves to promote the people that he loves. Amen. Daniel started from the bottom. Now he's here. I like to think I'm, okay. We'll let it go. Daniel worked his way up. God brought him to a place of promotion. And one thing that I love about God is he is looking to promote people, right? He's looking to bring the people who love him into positions of influence. But I love what it said about Daniel. It says that he was faithful, always trustworthy, are always responsible and completely trustworthy. Those were three things that Daniel had. And sometimes when people are looking to be promoted, because I don't know about you, I don't necessarily want to stay where I am for the rest of my life. I think we're all looking to advance, take steps towards our dreams, towards what God has called us to. If we're looking to do that, I would not focus on how quickly you could get there, but instead take the time to develop the character it takes to sustain what God is bringing to you. Amen? Are y'all hearing me tonight? Because sometimes it's easy to be like, people can get to the top quickly, but a lot of times they leave just as quickly because they didn't have what it took to sustain that. So I love that when these people were trying to tear Daniel down, and they were looking for ways to find fault in him, they found that he was faithful, always responsible, and completely trustworthy. Come on, somebody needed to hear that tonight. Here's what I love. I love that God is trying to promote you, but here's something that we have to understand. As we move forward into the dream of God for our lives, there will always be people who are trying to tear you down. There will always be people, as you move forward and as you are stepping forward, there will always be people that are trying to stop you. See, Daniel, here he was. He's going strong, guys. Things are going right. And like that, there are people who were actively trying to tear him down from the promotion that God had given him. See, as you move forward in your life and as you step into the things that God has called you to, do not be surprised when you encounter resistance. A lot of times that means you're doing something right. Come on, y'all hearing me tonight? Do not be surprised when you encounter resistance. Why? Because you actually have a real enemy. Hello? You have a real enemy. The Bible says this, that the devil prowls around seeking whom he may devour, right? We have an enemy who is actively trying to stop, trying to halt what God is doing in your life. Now, we don't have to be afraid of that. Why? Because we're on the winning team. Amen? We're on the winning team. Here's what it says in John 16:33. It says, these things I have spoken to you, that in me you may have peace. Listen to this. In the world you will have tribulation, but be of good cheer because I have overcome the world. Listen, this is Jesus talking right now. And he goes, guys, we got to get on the same page. Just because you've signed up to follow me, that doesn't mean that from now on it's going to be butterflies and fairies, right? There's going to be things that come against you in your life. There's going to be tribulation. Here's the best part. But he said, but be of good cheer. Why? Because I have overcome the world. Jesus has overcome the world. He is the overcomer. The overcomer lives on the inside of me, which makes me an overcomer. So I love that Jesus doesn't tell you, hey, in your life, you're going to encounter some tough things. He doesn't tell you that to scare you. Actually, in the beginning of the verse, it says, these things I have spoken to you that in me you may have peace. Hey, that's good news, you guys. Because there's some people who want to walk through life scared of what might happen in the future. Paralyzed by fear. Jesus is looking at us saying, let's get on the same page here. You're going to have some tough moments. But I'm telling you this so that you can have peace in me. It's found in me. Because I'm the overcomer and I'm in you, which makes you an overcomer. Amen? See, this is exactly what happens to Daniel. See, everything is good one moment. Come on, the king has promoted him to second in command over this entire nation. And then suddenly, two administrators are plotting against him. So they realize that the only way that they're going to bring Daniel down is through his relationship with God. Why? Because his relationship with God is non-negotiable. So they go to King Darius and they tell him, they're like, listen, King Darius, you're pretty awesome. You're an amazing king. Here's what we think you should do. We think that you should make a decree for 30 days that nobody can worship any human or God except you. And if they do, they will be thrown into the lion's den. And King Darius is like, oh, guys, you guys love me that much? What a great idea! Signed. And he signs into law that nobody for 30 days can worship any other god or any other human except King Darius. And the administrators, they knew what they were doing. They were trapping Daniel in this moment. And so that goes out into the law. Obviously, Daniel hears about this decree, which means certain death, right? He's at this point now faced with the fact that if he continues to worship God, if he continues to pray to his God, he's going to die. He's going to be thrown into the lion's den. Now, I'm about to read to you what Daniel does. And when I read this, I was like, oh my gosh, this is like incredible, the response that Daniel has in the face of death. Let's read it. This is in Daniel 6, 10 through 11. It says, but when Daniel learned about the law that had been signed, he went home and knelt down as usual in his upstairs room with its windows open towards Jerusalem. He prayed three times a day, just as he had always done, giving thanks to his God. Then the officials went together to Daniel's house and found him praying and asking for God's help. Guys, there is something so crazy about the way that Daniel responds to this. He gets the news. You will be thrown into the lion's den if you continue to worship God. Y'all, sometimes we say lion's den, and we don't understand how freaking intense that is. A den of lions. Y'all, a spider scares the crap out of me. If I see a spider, it's instant fetal position and crying and screaming. Y'all think I'm kidding. That's real talk right now. Me and spiders are not friends. So if a spider can scare me that much, I can't imagine the reality of if I continue to worship God, I'm going to be thrown into a den of hungry lions. That's so intense, but I love what he says. It says that when he learned about the law had been signed, he went home and knelt down as usual in his upstairs room with its windows open toward Jerusalem. He prayed three times a day, just as he had always done, giving thanks to God. He prayed three times a day, just as he had always done. Just as he had always done. And sometimes I don't think that we realize this. When we think about Daniel, we think of him as like a young guy, like maybe he's like in his 30s or something, like a young strapping man. No, he was actually like 80 at this point. So imagine he's got decades and decades and decades of three times a day he got on his face before God and had time with him. He had time with Jesus. He had time with his God. It says that he was giving thanks. So when you are thanking somebody, you are setting your attention on what they've done for you. And your response is thank you. So for decades and decades, multiple times a day, Daniel got on his face before God and thought about all the things that God had done for him. And when you do that, when you have that kind of discipline to set your attention on God, you know who God is. You know what he's capable of. And just like that, he's facing death. And his response is, I don't really care. I'm going to get on my knees, just like I've always done. See, the thing about Daniel is he had history with God. And it didn't matter the ridiculous circumstances that were suddenly coming out of nowhere. It didn't matter. He knew who his God was. He knew that God would take care of him. See, Daniel's ability to stand strong in the face of death was a direct result of Daniel's ability to be able to kneel before God. Y'all hearing me? Come on. Daniel's ability to stand strong in the face of death is a direct result of Daniel's ability to kneel before God. See, if you want to learn how to stand strong, you got to learn how to kneel before God. You got to learn how to get on your face and have time with your Savior. Now, do not see, because here's what religion wants to do. Religion wants to twist that, what I just said, into like this law now. If you don't pray three times a day, God will not help you. That's stupid religious crap. That's not what I'm saying. If there is any condemnation that you're feeling as I'm talking about that, you're not hearing me right. You're not hearing me right. Because I'm not saying, well, shame on you for not praying three times a day. I'm not saying that. What I'm saying is when you set as a priority on the inside of your heart to connect with God, to let him fill you up, when circumstances, hard circumstances, come against you, you're able to stand strong. See, Daniel shows us something really, really, really important. I want you guys to grab a hold of this. Because Daniel was 80. If we can get this now in our 20s, in this time of transition and craziness that's going on in our lives, if we can get this now, it will profoundly impact the way we live our lives in the future. Listen to this. How we prepare for the battle is being found in the presence of God and letting him fill you with strength before the battle. Did y'all hear me? How we prepare for the battle. Because He said, Jesus said, in this world you will have tribulations. We know that as we walk through life, there are going to be things that come against us. Now, how we prepare for the battle is being found in the presence of God, letting him fill you up with strength before the battle. See, he doesn't only want you to call upon him when you're in extreme distress. He wants to fill you up now. He wants to spend time with you now. He wants to love on you now, in this moment. So that when you're down the road and something comes against you, you go, no, no, no. I know who God is. I know that he's for me. And if you're in the middle of a battle right now, you're like, well, that's great. That's how I can prepare, but I'm in the middle of the battle right now. The best thing that you can know is that God is still for you. God will still strengthen you. God will still pour himself out. Come on, am I talking to y'all in here? Like, y'all with me here? It's like long distance running, friends. Do we have any runners in here? I can't see. Oh, good for you. Way to be winning at life. Yes. Listen, if I ran down this aisle to the door, I'd be like, I'd be sucking wind. Why? Because of the donuts. It's because of my commitment to donuts. I love them so much. But if tomorrow I had to run a marathon, come on, if I had to run a marathon, I would not be too far into the race before I was in the fetal position, sucking wind, dying of heat stroke. Hello? Can anyone relate? I don't run. I don't like to run. Why? Because I have not built up the endurance to be able to overcome that obstacle, right? But if I got up at 5 a.m. in the morning, which is an ungodly hour, I feel bad for people who have to get up that early. But if I got up that early and I went and trained and I ran and I had discipline and I was committed to it, I would be able to run a marathon, God willing. I would be able. Why? Because I have built the endurance, the strength, the endurance to be able to overcome that obstacle, to be able to run that race. See, the truth is that life is going to hit you at some point. And God says, I want to fill you with strength. Y'all, that's good news. He goes, I'm never going to leave you. I'm never going to forsake you. Listen, you can stand strong. Not only can you stand strong, but you will overcome and you will have victory. So what I want to do is I'm going to read some scriptures. If you are in the middle of a battle right now, it doesn't matter what it is. It could be financial. It could be relational. It could be physical. Whatever you're dealing with right now and you're having to walk through it, I'm going to read four passages of scripture, and I want you to write down the scripture reference. And I want you to be able to go back when you're having a hard time standing strong to remind you that he is your strength. And if you're not in a battle right now, write them down anyway. Put them in your phone because you're going to need them. So the first one we're going to look at is Psalms 46, verse 1. It says this, God is our refuge and strength, always ready to help in times of trouble. God is our refuge and our strength, always ready to help in times of trouble. Psalms 28, verse 7. The Lord is my strength and shield. I trust him with all of my heart. He helps me, and my heart is filled with joy. I burst out in songs of thanksgiving. Isaiah 12, verse 2. It says, see, God has come to save me. I will trust in him and not be afraid. The Lord God is my strength and my song. He has given me what? Victory. Come on, guys. This is so good. Are you guys reading this? This is ridiculous. Isaiah 40, 29 through 31. He gives power to the weak and strength to the powerless. Come on. Even youths will be weak and tired, and young men will fall in exhaustion. But those who trust in the Lord will find new strength. They will soar high on the wings like eagles. They will run and not grow weary. They will walk and not faint. Come on, God is your strength. Come on, God is your strength. And you might say, listen, I've been in a battle for a long time. And I'm really tired. Let's go back to Isaiah 40. It says he gives power to the weak and strength to the powerless. But those who trust in the Lord will find new strength. Yeah, new strength. He renews it. You need it, he's got it. So let's get back to the story of Daniel. So basically, Daniel was like, forget it. I'm worshiping Jesus. I'm going to pray like I've always done. Okay? And King Darius finds out that Daniel has now been arrested. King Darius is actually devastated. And it says, the Bible says that he spends all day trying to figure out how to get around the law, how to save Daniel. But he couldn't do it because he made the law. So Daniel gets thrown into the lion's den, which sucks. Sucks for Daniel. He gets thrown into the lion's den for an entire night. So this is the next morning where we're picking up. This is the next morning. It's Daniel 6, 19 through 23, excuse me. It says, very early the next morning, the king got up and hurried out to the lion's den. When he got there, he called out in anguish, Daniel, servant of the living God, was your God, whom you serve so faithfully, able to rescue you from the lions? Daniel answered, long live the king. My God sent his angel to shut the lion's mouth so that they would not hurt me. For I have been found innocent in his sight. And I have not wronged you, your majesty. The king was overjoyed and ordered that Daniel be lifted from the den. Not a scratch was found on him, for he had trusted in his God. Come on. Not a scratch was found on him because he trusted in his God. God shut the mouths of the lions. The very thing that was looking to kill and to destroy Daniel. God said, he shut the mouths. Do you believe that God tonight will shut the mouths of whatever is coming against you? Because that's what it comes down to. Do you believe that God will do the same thing that he did for Daniel? It said that not a scratch was found on him, for he had trusted in his God. I love the trust that Daniel displayed. Even though he was facing death, he knew that he could trust in God. And mezzanine, I'm here tonight to remind you and to show you in Scripture that you can trust in God. That God sees where you're at. God sees what you're walking through, and you can trust in him. I really felt like God wanted to pour out strength tonight onto every heart that is in this room. I felt like God wanted to pour out strength on every person. Why? To remind you not to give up. Not to give in, but to stand strong and know that the God of the universe is on your side. The God of the universe is fighting for you. So whatever the doctor said, whatever relationship didn't work out, whatever's going on in your family, whatever's going on at work, whatever in your finances, whatever mountain you're looking at, it is not too big for him. And he's giving you strength to be able to look that thing in the face and say, I know my God's going to take care of me. So basically, King Darius is super excited that Daniel is alive. The Bible says that he was overjoyed. And what really sucks for the guys who tricked King Darius into doing that to Daniel, Bible also says that he threw them and their families into the lion's den as well, and the lions tore them to shreds, which is super sad for them, but that's what happened. So you can see that it wasn't that the lions weren't hungry. It was an act of God, right? But this is what Daniel said. What the book of Daniel says. This is what happened next. Daniel 6, verse 25 through 27, it says, "Then King Darius sent this message to the people of every race and every nation and language throughout the world. Peace and prosperity to you. I decree that everyone throughout my kingdom should tremble with fear before the God of Daniel. For he is living, he is the living God, and he will endure forever. His kingdom will never be destroyed, and his rule will never end. He rescues and saves his people. He performs miraculous signs and wonders in heaven and on earth. He has rescued Daniel from the power of the lions." Here's what I felt like the Lord was showing me tonight. That not only did God promote Daniel, not only did God rescue Daniel from the things that he was facing, but God put Daniel in a position to be next to King Darius. King Darius was not a believer in God. But King Darius got to witness what God did on Daniel's behalf. The result of that is that King Darius decreed to the entire nation, he says, "Listen, you're going to serve Daniel's God. We're going to worship Daniel's God." Why? Because he is the God who saves. He is the God who endures. Y'all, are y'all getting this? A secular world leader saw Daniel's breakthrough. And the result of that was that a nation was changed like that. Y'all. That's right, Caitlin. Dang, Daniel. That is so intense. Here's my question to you. Do you believe not only that God cares about you and sees where you're at and is going to bring you to victory, but do you believe that God is so good that he will position you next to decision makers, leaders, your boss, business owners, CEOs, so that they would see what God does in your life and that environments, cities, states, and nations will be changed? Do you believe that God could use you in that way? I want to be used like that. Because here's what I love about God. God so intimately cared about Daniel and what Daniel was facing. And he dealt with Daniel on a personal level. But God also saw so far beyond that one moment, that one situation. That's why God is so good, y'all. He sees beyond what we can see in the moment. And God wants to set you up. Listen, King Darius championed David, loved David, was devastated when he realized that David was going to be David. Daniel. Sorry. He loved Daniel. He championed Daniel. He was so sad when he realized that Daniel was going to be thrown into the lion's den. Do you believe that God could set you up with secular world leaders who would love you, champion you, fight for you, want to work with you? That's what God wants to do. And like that, a nation can change. I want to set my faith to that kind of radical breakthrough, that God would use your breakthrough to break through to people who don't know him. Come on. God wants to use your breakthrough to break through to people who don't know him. That's what God is doing tonight. Amanda, you can come on up. Prayer counselors, come on up to the front. Tonight, I felt like the Lord wanted me to specifically remind you that he is here tonight. He cares and he sees what you're walking through, and he is pouring out new strength tonight. It does not matter how long you've been in the battle or how long you've been fighting. He is right there beside you. And I felt this in my spirit tonight, that there would be a spirit of breakthrough tonight. And you know what's super fun is in worship, Sue and Summer came up to me and they said that they felt like the Lord was just kind of showing them celebration. And I was like, oh, that's pretty awesome. Because when you break through in an area that you've been fighting and you've been dealing with, and there's breakthrough in your life, it is cause for celebration. And so the fact that they saw that, they heard God whisper that to their hearts, that tonight's going to be a night of celebration, goes to show that tonight is a night of breakthrough for people. If that is physically in your body, you've been dealing with something, tonight is a night of breakthrough. Financially, relationally, I felt like the Lord was just going to be almost like dumping hope into people's hearts. God is causing us to stand strong. In the face of tough circumstances, God is right there. He's right there. And you will see victory. Amen? Come on. Grab a hold of that tonight. Let your heart grab a hold of that tonight. You will see victory. What did that one verse say in Psalms? Says, or nope, not Psalms, Isaiah 12. See, God has come to save me. I will trust in him and not be afraid. The Lord God is my strength and my song. He has given me victory. Come on. Tonight is a night of victory for you. So here's what I want to do. I want us all just bow your heads wherever you are at. And if that's you tonight, and you're like, I need breakthrough tonight. I need strength tonight. I want you to just hold your hands out in front of you like you're going to receive something. Like I'm going to hand you something, and you're about to grab it. What we're going to do is we're going to pray. We're going to pray over you and declare victory. And I want your heart to believe it. Trust in him. Lord, I thank you for what you showed us tonight in the book of Daniel. God, I thank you that you are a God who shuts the mouths of the lions. Right now, I declare breakthrough and freedom in every heart in this place right now, God. Just do it, Holy Spirit, do it. Lord, that physically, emotionally, relationally, financially, there would be just heaven invading that problem. And Lord, right now I release hope into every heart. God, for the first time in a long time, I just see people being able to take a deep breath and that they would know that they're going to be okay. Yeah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Lord, I release right now hope, that hope would just begin to rise. That hope would just begin to rise right now. Lord, we intentionally rest in you right now. We rest in you. That is the best way to fight the battle, is to rest in you. God, wrap your arms around us tonight and remind us of who you are. You are good, you are faithful, you are fierce, and you love us. Thank you, Lord, for what's taking place right now in every heart and every mind. I declare breakthrough, I declare freedom, I declare hope right now. We begin to rise. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So here's what I want us to do. If that's you tonight, if that hit your heart, if you're like, man, I need strength, I need to stand strong, I want you to come down to the front. Man, y'all, these people, sometimes, let me tell you something. Sometimes when you're in the middle of the battle and you're in the middle of walking through something, it takes somebody who's outside of it to come alongside you and say, come on, we're going to believe for breakthrough. We're going to believe for victory. Don't give in to, it's not that big of a deal. I'm just going to sit in my seat. I'm just going to head out. No, come on, tonight's the night. Come down here. Let one of these prayer counselors look you in the face and say, we're going to do this. We're going to break through. That's what's happening right now. Be brave and come down here and get prayer. Because tonight is the night of celebration. Come on, we're going to celebrate what God did. And it's going to be ridiculously awesome. So that's you. I want you to come down. You guys, that has been the mezzanine. And I'm so thankful you guys are here. And I can't wait to see you guys next week. Next week, Pastor David's going to bring the word. And it's going to be awesome. So make sure that you're here next week. But thank you guys. I love you guys. And come down and get prayer.
Hey guys, that was a great message. That was awesome. If you guys need prayer or you guys want to let us know anything that God moved on your heart, just hit the prayer icon and let us know. I'll see you next week.